A few weeks before Vladimir Putin launched the full-scale invasion of Ukraine in February last year, one of Russia's best-known journalists was jointly awarded the Nobel Peace Prize for efforts to safeguard freedom of expression.
Yes, we growl and bite. Yes, we have sharp teeth and strong grip. But we are the prerequisite for progress. We are the antidote against tyranny.
Dmitry Muratov, the editor-in-chief of Novaya Gazeta, was talking about the silencing of critical voices.
Journalism in Russia is going through a dark valley. Journalists, media outlets, human rights defenders, and NGOs have been branded foreign agents. In Russia, this means enemies of the people. Many of our colleagues have lost their jobs. Some have to leave the country. Some are deprived of the opportunity to live a normal life for an unknown period of time, maybe forever.
Six of Muratov's colleagues were killed in the last two decades for doing their job in Russia, covering wars, investigating issues of public interest, and trying to hold those in power to account. Last year, Novaya Gazeta was suspended, its license revoked, and its website blocked, along with hundreds of other publications. The defanging of independent journalism was nearly complete.
What's left is this bleak, barren landscape where activism is an offence and you only do what you are allowed to do. So what kind of civil society is it? It's very difficult not to get a chilling sense of déjà vu.
BBC Monitoring's Russia editor, Vitaly Shevchenko, has been watching the country for over two decades, so the latest crackdown did not come as a surprise to him.
What happened on the 24th of February 2022 would not have been possible without a lot of prep work by the Russian government. I mean, the near total annihilation of domestic opponents, media restrictions which created an environment which was easy to manipulate. What does that mean for media freedoms in Russia? It means that they don't really exist. We are left with a journalistic scene that almost entirely toes the official Kremlin line.
In today's Global Jigsaw, we track the gradual dismantling of Russia's independent media, from color and vibrancy under Boris Yeltsin in the 90s to the extreme crackdown under Vladimir Putin a quarter of a century later. And we look into a new propaganda push targeting the youngest. I'm Krassi Twigg, and this is the Global Jigsaw, an original podcast from BBC Monitoring, zooming in on political, security and social shifts around the world through the lens of its media. Our team listens to, watches and analyzes media narratives in 100 languages.
Радіо Тегеран.
Right, we must go now to Moscow.
Ми не вторгались на територію України.
Western countries are not the international community. That era has finished.
I mean, have you got any thoughts on
that?
The analysis you'll hear today is informed by years of professional work and personal experiences. The colleagues I spoke to were either born in Russia or lived there. Some worked for state-affiliated media, while others covered the country from the outside. You'll hear from Olga Robinson, Vitaly Shevchenko, Francis Scar, Kriszta Satori, and Howard Gethin from BBC Monitoring, and Olga Ivshina from BBC Russian. Our subject brought back childhood memories for Olga Robinson.
I actually physically remember how the Russian media landscape changed, because in my family we didn't have remote control, so my parents constantly used me to change channels.
Olga caught a bit of the late 90s on Russian TV and has muscle memory of the variety of TV programs.
When we were watching news, I do remember over time that I would switch the channels and they were all talking about different things.
It's hard not to look back at the late 90s without a sense of nostalgia. Independent journalism flourished. TV channels delivered for audiences of different political persuasion, and newspapers could sink their teeth into stories that mattered. Vitaly remembers those times.
If we look back at how things were after Perestroika, at how things were in the 1990s, that was a time of immense hope, particularly in terms of media freedoms. If you looked at newspapers such as Komsomolskaya Pravda, at TV stations such as NTV, they were the epitome of daring, insightful, incisive journalism that was unafraid and almost impossible to intimidate.
But that didn't last long after the arrival of Vladimir Putin on the big political scene in 1999. Olga recalls sensing a change in the mood while she was channel surfing.
They were increasingly talking about the same thing and roughly using the same words. So, and that really is one of my childhood memories. I remember how that disappeared and how channels just became incredibly homogenous.
The homogenization of the national TV channels proceeded swiftly. The process of bringing into line most of the media unfolded over two decades. BBC Russian's Olga Ivshina put together a fact file detailing some of the most important milestones.
In 1993, Russia's new constitution guaranteed press freedom and prohibited censorship. It seemed to put the Soviet past firmly behind it. But since then, Russia has seen an ever-tightening series of laws stifling the media and dissent. In 1999, as the Second Chechen War broke out, Russia moved to censor journalists from freely reporting the conflict. In 2003, a new telecoms law was passed, compelling firms to provide any information requested by state officials, if ordered to by the courts. In 2006, extremism laws were amended, meaning media outlets that criticized federal or local officials or political organizations could be prosecuted. 2014 saw Russia's occupation of Crimea and a ban on foreigners owning more than 20% of Russia's media firms. That year, VK social networking site founder Pavel Durov left Russia after refusing to hand over the Ukrainian activist data to the FSB. In 2016, Russia amended its counterterrorism laws, requiring telecom operators to keep recordings of phone conversations, texts, and users' internet traffic for up to 6 months, and their metadata for up to 3 years. 2019 saw spreading so-called false news become a criminal offense, while a 2020 constitutional amendment criminalized questioning the state narrative. Most recently, in 2022, just after Russia's invasion of Ukraine, Parliament passed a law imposing 15-year jail terms for spreading so-called fake news about the military.
The first major attempt to force Russia's media into line was launched when Vladimir Putin was Boris Yeltsin's prime minister during the Second Chechen War in 1999, as a result of the volatile southern region's renewed attempt to break away from Russia. This bit of insight I know from Kriszta Satori, who's the producer of this podcast. She covered Chechnya for German public media.
In the first Chechen War, the Russian media did an excellent job. They were all on the ground, fantastic access to both sides. They covered human rights violations, they questioned the motives, they followed soldiers' mothers who tried to retrieve their sons from the front line. Colleagues from Russian TV held Boris Yeltsin's feet to the fire often at press conferences and wherever they could. And that was a very marked difference to how they reported the Second Chechen War. What Moscow deemed as anti-terrorist operation along the lines of what they call the current war in Ukraine. And there are some other similarities too. War crimes, mass graves, the use of sledgehammer, Moscow's anti-terrorist operation in Chechnya started with bombardments of the capital, Grozny. They rolled in hundreds of tanks. Nearly half of the population was displaced within months. And journalist access was restricted. Some were allowed on so-called Kremlin-organized tours, and very few others were embedded with Moscow's troops.
Этого человека зовут Олег. Он наводит штурмовики на позиции боевиков, координируя точность попадания ракет по целям.
And then even fewer of us who worked inside Chechnya and brought testimonies of the people who were under those bombs to the world. We did this at great personal risk and with long-standing consequences.
Let's hear from the man himself, who as president-elect told the BBC what he was trying to achieve in Chechnya. The date is March 2000.
Началось освоение этой территории вот этими экстремистскими силами.
These extremist forces were nurtured from abroad. I'm not even mentioning the literal genocide of Russian speakers there. These bandits are not better than the Nazis. We are liberating the Chechen people from this disease. We are trying to minimize the losses of the civilians, which are negligible anyway. And one thing we know for sure is that one of the forms of warfare is information war.
Мы знаем, что одна из форм борьбы – это информационная борьба.
Sounds familiar? He said this 22 years before Russia launched its full-scale war against Ukraine. Back then, many Russian TV channels were towing the Kremlin's line on Chechnya, significantly boosting Putin's popularity with viewers. Only a few independent and foreign outlets dared to go against the grain. Here's a report from the BBC's Andrew Harding from that time.
Russian soldiers shout out Happy New Year as they send another shell hurtling into Grozny. It's a new millennium, but the same old savage war in Chechnya. This war is becoming uglier by the day.
Howard on our Russia team has another example of how Putin viewed the role of the media early on. Here's what the acting president thought of those who bring news from the other side of that war.
There was a biography published called From the First Person, and there was a chunk about a Radio Liberty journalist called Andrei Babitsky. And Babitsky was reporting a lot on the sort of Chechen side of the war, and he was kidnapped by the Russian military and threatened and thought he was going to be killed. And afterwards, Putin said that what Babitsky did is much more dangerous than firing a machine gun. So that was quite a indicative of how he thought journalists should behave.
Vitaly, like other Russia watchers, was trying to make sense of this political newcomer. He says Putin's attitude to the war in Chechnya was a big giveaway.
I think it started not even on day one, when Vladimir Putin was appointed as caretaker president, right at the start of the year 2000. Even before that happened, Putin, an unknown quantity, was apparently being groomed to take some reins of power. And the only thing that most people seemed to know about Putin was that he was from the KGB. The Chechen wars were one big reason why the Russian public became more accepting of Vladimir Putin. What he was able to offer is a choice between an uncontrolled kind of democracy where buildings are being blown up and various regions rebel and seek succession, and the other choice was tighter controls, more stability, more prosperity because of Vladimir Putin's skilled effort to harness petrodollar revenue and use it to keep the state machine well-oiled and well-running. That's what played in his favour in a big way.
Vladimir Putin quickly became popular, and part of his appeal was language that had never been heard from the Kremlin before. We rubbed them out in the outhouse, he said of Chechens he accused of terrorism. The phrase got picked up by Kukli, a satirical puppet show on NTV, the privately owned independent channel, which was a firm favorite with Russian liberal audiences. A bit like Spitting Image in the UK or Les Guignols in France. The show depicted Putin as an evil gnome who a group of villagers mistook for a beautiful young man. Talking about this kind of language taking hold, another phrase used by Putin on Ukraine in February 2022 raised eyebrows worldwide. Недавно заявил, что мне один пункт не нравится из этих Минских соглашений. Но нравится, не нравится, терпи, моя красавица. Надо исполнять. Like it or not, my beauty, you have to put up with it, he says here. Many commentators accused Russia's president of using language that seems to normalize rape. His press secretary had to explain that Vladimir Putin was talking strictly about the fulfilling of the Minsk agreement in the Donbas region of Ukraine.
Vladimir Putin's language has everything to do with his ideology and his objectives for Russia as a state. It's rough. It's difficult to translate. It can be insulting. All this talk about killing people in the outhouse, all the sexual innuendo, some of it with really violent overtones about whether you like it or not, you'll just have to endure it. It betrays a certain attitude to people. And one reason why he's using it is to galvanize, enrage, motivate. So this kind of language goes a long way to mobilizing this crowd of people willing to go and fight in Ukraine for whatever reason, because it's the kind of language that Vladimir Putin may have heard in the streets of St. Petersburg. This is the kind of language that all these convicts who are fighting as part of Wagner mercenary group in Ukraine, this is the kind of language that speaks to them.
Kukli, the NTV puppet show, was swiftly dealt with.
Kukli, puppets, completely irreverential. One of those kukli were political leaders right at the very top, were parodied, satirized. Fast forward 20 years, completely impossible now. There are people you can't say anything critical about, not on TV. And programs such as Kukli, they were one of the first victims of this emerging trend to stamp out dissent.
Kukli was just the first thorn in the side of the Kremlin. Another embarrassment came in the shape of the coverage of Putin's response to a maritime tragedy in August 2000. Howard recalls some of the consequences for the offending TV stations.
NTV was a commercially run TV station owned by an oligarch called Vladimir Kuczynski. And after the submarine Kursk sank, NTV showed Putin on his jet ski, you know, running around on the coastal resort Sochi instead of coming back to Moscow to deal with the problem of what happened with the Kursk. After that, he immediately realized what had happened. And basically, they took over NTV from Kuczynski. Kuczynski was arrested and threatened with being locked up. And they let him out, and he immediately fled the country. And Putin said, well, basically the deal is you give up NTV. So he did. So that was an example of how he had realized the importance of television and also how committed he was to controlling it.
Taking a very general look at his tenure, it seems that there's a certain logic to it. NTV was actually one of the first major media sources to be taken over by people very close to the Kremlin. Very quickly, within a matter of 1 year, more or less, it went from an outspoken, independent media outlet to a very tightly controlled government mouthpiece.
NTV was followed by ORT, which is now called Pervy Kanal, or First Channel. ORT was controlled by another oligarch, Boris Berezovsky. In August 2000, this channel put on air a critical investigative report of the Kursk, Putin's first major PR crisis.
Подводники. Способ жить и способ умирать. Версия президента. Флот разрушили люди с телевидения.
The reporter of the program, Sergei Dorenko, was fired. He never presented on network television again. Within a few months, ORT changed hands too. Its previous owner, Berezovsky, left Russia and settled in London, where he later died.
Over the decades that followed, restrictions were tightened further and further until on the 24th of February 2022, Vladimir Putin was confident enough that when he launched his special military operation, there would be no forces, no voices within Russia that would mount a realistic challenge to his move.
You are listening to The Global Jigsaw
from BBC Monitoring.
Back in 2000, foreign leaders found appeal in this young new leader. In his first year in power, Vladimir Putin met Tony Blair 5 times and seemed to have got on well with George W. Bush too.
Answer the question. I looked the man in the eye. I found him to be very straightforward and trustworthy. And we had a very good dialogue.
And while back at home, his forces kept bombarding Chechnya's capital Grozny, Vladimir Putin was toying with the idea of Russia joining NATO.
Почему нет? Я не исключаю такой возможности. Повторяю, в том случае, если с интересами России будут считаться.
And he said, "Yeah, why not? I can't really see Russia being isolated. We are an integral part of global security, European security. If we're treated equally, we will happily become part of NATO." Fast forward 20 years, NATO is the devil. Literally, if you listen to Russian state TV, there's a lot of talk of Satanism. And Russia is fighting not just those fictional neo-Nazis in Ukraine, but Satan himself.
So here's a question. Are there two Putins? Have there been two Putins all along?
I do think that the version that we saw back then in the early 2000s was a facade carefully maintained by a KGB operative. That's what he skillfully did while pursuing this ultimate objective in restoring what he saw as Russia's might, making Russia respected again. The reality at the end of this project is that his credible opponents are either in jail or in exile or dead.
Francis Carr is another colleague who is watching Russian TV for a living. You can listen back to one of our previous episodes, Russia's Propaganda Firehose, where Francis talks about the message beamed into living rooms. He kept a close eye on the independent media too.
If we go back a decade or so, state TV was very much the primary source of information for Russians. In fact, it was even more popular than it is now, with around 80% of people naming it as their primary source of information, as opposed to around 65% in 2023. What was different, however, was that the main independent TV channel, TV Rain or Dozhd in Russian, was available on the same platform that all the other channels until 2014, when they held a very controversial poll marking the 70th anniversary of the lifting of the siege of Leningrad in World War II. And they asked viewers whether Joseph Stalin should have given up Leningrad in order to save hundreds of thousands of lives, the people who died as a result of the siege and starving in the city. And this created a wave of criticism and led to the channel being moved off the main TV platform and operated online as it still does today.
You have been actively monitoring Russia since 2018. Were you able to see the writing on the wall from those early days?
I think the situation has got steadily worse since I've been watching Russia. We've seen various censorship scandals in newspapers, professionally minded journalists walking out after pro-Kremlin editors were appointed from above by the newspaper's shareholders. That happened in Kommersant and Vedomosti, two of what were considered Russia's flagship business papers, almost like the FT or the Wall Street Journal in the West. We also saw journalists being murdered, especially those working for Nova Gazeta, which has gained this reputation for independent reporting since the fall of the Soviet Union.
A few outlets were able to maintain editorial independence even after the annexation of Crimea in 2014, which is seen as another watershed moment in the Kremlin's crackdown on critical voices. How come some independent media could still exist up until last February?
I think we can point to a number of factors. One of them is simply that up to a point, the Kremlin was willing to tolerate dissent as long as it didn't feel threatened by that dissent. And I think in terms of Echo Moskvy and Dozhd, it always felt that their audiences were not significant enough to pose any kind of genuine threat to Putin, especially after he crushed a wave of protests in 2011 and 2012. Another factor, I think, is that it was perhaps window dressing for the West, and it allowed Russia to continue to portray itself as a democracy, albeit a flawed one, and not attract the same kind of opprobrium that the likes of China or North Korea or Iran do in the West.
The 2011 rallies on Bolotnaya Square in Moscow, just across the river from the Kremlin, attracted tens of thousands of Moscovites protesting against what they called a float electoral process. Those were the largest opposition demonstrations the city had seen in decades. Back then, Howard was working for the RIA Novosti news agency and remembers how they reported the rallies.
We were covering those demonstrations and sending correspondence to the demonstrations and writing the slogans that people were shouting. And pressure was put on my bosses to stop, to discontinue that practice and to not send people to those demonstrations. But he stuck it out and it continued. RIA Novosti was run at that time by Svetlana Miranyuk, and she was quite intent on making RIA Novosti more like a Western news agency. And when Putin came back, things started to change quite rapidly. And, of course, in the end, she was booted out and Dmitry Kislyov was put in charge. And it wasn't self-censorship anymore, it was censorship.
One of the key objectives pursued by the Kremlin is not just to shield the Russian public from undesirable information, but also to make Russians think that nothing is to be trusted. You can't believe anything. And most importantly, because of this, you shouldn't even try to do anything about it. And the objective is creating a very apathetic society where activism is seen not just as dangerous, but also pointless.
Most of the protesters at Bolotnaya Square were young, and this drew the Kremlin's attention to that segment of the audience.
Well, children, young people are genuinely incredibly important for the Kremlin. If you don't catch those younger generations within your influence, then they might have a completely different mindset, a completely different set of values. They might not necessarily be supportive of the Kremlin. And I think when really young people turned up at protests that were supporting the Russian opposition and opposition leader Alexei Navalny, that really spooked the Russian authorities. There's been a great demand on the part of the Kremlin to tackle young people.
Olga experienced it for herself when she took part in a famous youth gathering on Lake Seliga, 400 kilometers from Moscow.
Every single year, the Seliga camp was massively advertised on television. Lots of attention, lots of really high-profile speakers for essentially youngsters and kids. And it was quite a mind-blowing experience and probably my first encounter with an event that's all about patriotism and really hardcore patriotism. I can't really describe it in any other way. You're in the middle of the woods and you wake up in the morning to the sound of Russian national anthem, and then you all have to go to obligatory morning training exercises to patriotic music with people on stage shouting something. That is followed by a day full of lectures and seminars with people from Russian state TV, from Russian officials, some well-known public figures.
The Russian president himself has often visited to engage with the Seliger camp audience.
I remember seeing all these posters with quotes from Putin and quotes from Medvedev about education, about the kind of love for Russia.
So it didn't make you feel more patriotic?
It certainly seemed to have had some effect on people, and they really joined in singing songs and listening to lectures. And one of the lecturers was actually a really well-known TV presenter. He mentioned, almost like a throwaway line, but for some reason stuck with me, that propaganda needs to be elegant.
You are listening to The Global Jigsaw
from BBC Monitoring.
The push for patriotism wasn't confined to summer camps only. Howard noticed how the volume was turned up recently in most educational institutions at all levels.
Children of young primary school age, as soon as they start school, effectively, are going to be doing patriotic lessons and military preparation in schools, which was a Soviet-era practice, like stripping down rifles and learning combat first aid. And if people go to university, starting in September of this year, there's going to be a compulsory program of Russian ideology taught at university level and also military training.
This brings back memories because I had military education in school and we had to disassemble a Kalashnikov within a minute. So how did the militarization of Russia's school age population start? Because we are seeing lots of pictures of really young kids wearing military uniform and getting into the whole military spirit.
Children have been seen parading with teachers and wearing military uniform. Also youth movements coming back again. There's a Yunarmiya, or young army, which is for teenagers, really. And another old Soviet thing that's coming back are the pioneers.
No one escapes indoctrination in Russia. It starts at a very early age. Increasingly militaristic rituals entering nursery schools, primary schools in Russia. Every year, Victory Day generates a torrent of videos showing toddlers being dressed up in military uniforms, the prams being decorated as tanks, little children goose-stepping, as soldiers given toy guns.
Let's hear from Olga, who went through the Russian school system in the Putin era.
Soon after he came to power and became president, his portrait started to appear in my school. We also saw some of the, you know, flags, state symbols. It would be obligatory to have them in schools, but also we all had to learn the new anthem by heart and we had to recite them.
During a recent visit to her school, Olga noticed a marked difference, which surprised her.
I went and voted in my school, and I do remember being quite shocked at just how many portraits of Putin there were and how many quotes on the walls and how many patriotic symbols and Russian flags. It just looked completely like a different level from what I used to. It used to be just one portrait and the flag and the words of the hymn. That change happened really gradually. It didn't happen overnight. It sort of was introduced bit by bit, but I think it really went up a notch in terms of intensity after the annexation of Crimea.
And it's not just the decoration that changed. It's the curriculum too, teaching kids to understand the world the Russian way. History matters to Vladimir Putin, judging by the number of his speeches on historical topics. Olga's team has checked out the latest editions of history books from 2022, These are being introduced now in the occupied areas of Ukraine too.
And they barely mention Ukraine. So Kiev and Rus is not Kiev and Rus anymore, it's just Rus. And there's a lot of talk about Putin lionizing the actions of Putin. I think one of the initiatives that is quite striking in itself was actually launched last year, and it's called Talks About the Important Things. And it is extracurricular. Technically, you can opt out, but
anecdotally, we've seen evidence of both teachers and children being in trouble for not attending those, including up to the level of being dismissed or undergoing some psychological assessment when it comes to children.
This initiative, the talk about important things, leaves little space to opt out. Here's more detail from Howard about how it works.
It might be something as innocuous as a speaker coming to a school and giving a presentation, but actually it's a way of presenting Russia's view on current affairs. So it's a kind of a version of what they used to do in the military in the Soviet time, really, where soldiers were indoctrinated. And there won't be any attempt to present alternative viewpoints. This is firmly Russia's point of view and what it means to be patriotic in Russia today.
Listen to this clip from the website of Russia's Ministry of Education, part of the official supplementary material for the talks about important things.
Разгромить фашизм, Россия прекратит свое существование.
A World War II veteran telling primary school-aged children that it is volunteers fighting in Ukraine. And although the West blames the war on Moscow, Russia did not start it. War has a special role in the Russian identity construct, as Olga explains.
Victory Day always has been incredibly important for Russians. Let's not forget that the Soviet Union lost well over 20 million people, and obviously pretty much every single family has somebody who's been lost in the war. So it started as a Remembrance Day, and then it gradually became more and more militaristic. It became more of a show of Russia's military might. When I was really small, I could hear all the time, never again. That phrase was gradually replaced with, we can do it again, meaning we can defeat the modern-day Nazis or whoever we see as modern-day Nazis. And this kind of more extreme rhetoric, it really came to the fore after the annexation of Crimea. I would start seeing stickers on cars saying that we can do it again. We can show the world that we're the victors. It's not about the horror of the war. It's about victory and the fact that Russians are always in the right.
At a recent 6-day-long festival of patriotic anti-fascist songs, the same message was repeated again from the stage. Russia never starts wars, says the announcer, talking about how Russians fighting in Ukraine are following in the footsteps of those fighting fascism. We are in the right. We will win, he ends.
It just turned into the essence, the basis of the ideology of the Russian state. Victory Day was taken by the Russian authorities and turned into a completely different concept of Russian supremacy, of Russia's military might and Russia's superiority over other nations.
It's been able to create a certain public consensus in Russia centered around Kremlin ideology, with all that it entails, including the war with Ukraine. If you are critical of it, at least in public, you stand out, and few people want that. It's a devastating experience. It's the intellectual erosion that you witness on a daily basis.
The apathy of Russians over the last 20 years has in many ways facilitated Russia's journey to its current state and the lack of a democratic opposition and the lack of independent media now within the country, which to some extent the Russian population has responsibility for.
The prospect of Russia getting back some of its media freedoms and civil society doesn't seem on the horizon. But even Vitaly hasn't lost all hope.
It's going to be hard work to move from an passively acquiescent society to an active, activist society where ideas are debated and questioned. We are extremely far away from that point. What gives me hope is the number of Russian journalists dedicated to their ideals of impartial, independent reporting, who still pursue their ideal fearlessly, the personal price they've paid is also not to be ignored. They've had to leave Russia. Some have been targeted with violence. Some have been jailed. But the fact that so many of them are still determined to continue telling what they see as the truth to make this world a bit better, to make this awful, tragic situation end as soon as possible, that is what gives me heart. And I think this is where the hope rests. And the indications of Russian civil society re-emerging, I think they will first be seen in the impact these media have within Russia and the freedom with which they can operate within Russia. This will be the litmus paper.
Remember Dmitry Muratov, the editor-in-chief of Novaya Gazeta and Nobel Peace Prize laureate? He auctioned off his medal for a record $100 million to raise funds for Ukrainian child refugees. Mikhail Gorbachev, the father of glasnost and perestroika, used the money from his Nobel Peace Prize to help set up Novaya Gazeta in 1993. The 2022 laureate is Oleg Orlov, the co-chair of the Russian human rights group Memorial. He's on trial in Moscow, charged with discrediting the Russian military for his opposition to the war in Ukraine. Thanks to Vitaly Shevchenko, Olga Robinson, Francis Carr, Howard Gethin, and Olga Ivshina. The producers of The Global Jigsaw are Krista Satori and Lucy Bailey. Original music is by Pete Cunningham. Our studio engineer is Nigel Dix, the editor is Judy King, and I am Krassi Twigg. If you liked today's episode, you can listen to our previous editions which explore Russia's influence operations abroad. You can get in touch with us on The Global Jigsaw, all one word, at bbc.co.uk.